Good morning. What? Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh my goodness, it must be hump day. Good morning. How is everybody doing today? I'm extremely happy today, not only because it's hump day, but I found out yesterday some good things. Yesterday we had a good day. I'm glad that everybody came out. Also yesterday I found out that my Toronto Maple Leafs have clinched another playoff series. Okay? Yes, if you're a Leaf fan, come on, rejoice with me. Come on. Okay, thank you very much. Good. Now, to get started, we're going to do one thing, then we're going to do the drum, opening prayer, then go into the keynote. Okay? So first off, first things first. I know we had breakfast. It was a good thank you. Thank you. No rester. Yay. That was good. They were probably up like at 6 o'clock while you guys were still sleeping. Okay? So first things first, we need to feel good about each other. So what I need you to do is I need you to stand up and find a partner, somebody close by, not too far. Go ahead, stand up. Come on, ginnipi. In Cree, we say ginnipi. Find somebody quickly. Come on. If you're still eating, that's okay. Share your mouth. Okay, now without that you found your partner, I want you to face them face to face. Like nose to nose. No, I'm kidding. Just face to face is good. Don't be shy. Come on. Let's go. Okay, you're going to need a partner. So try to find somebody. Not a three-way kind of thing. Okay? Okay, here we go. Now, between the both of you, what I would like you to do is decide who's going to go first. Voluntel, who's going to go first? Okay? Now, the person that's going first, you're going to repeat after me, and you're going to look at your partner and repeat after me. Good morning. I would like to say, you're beautiful, and you're amazing, and I love your eyes. Oh, doesn't that feel good? Okay, now, the person that's listening, it's your turn to talk. So repeat after me and look at your partner. Aw, thank you. You're amazing as well. I would like to say, you're so hot, the sun is jealous. All right, perfect, good. Now, the first person that went first, okay, you're going to turn your back to your friend, okay? Turn your back on your friend, okay? And when I say the word G-O, you're going to turn around and try to make that person laugh with your best angry or scary-looking face, whatever. All you're doing is you're going to try to make them smile, okay? 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, reverse the role. Second place person is going to go next. Ready? On your mark, set, go. Okay, perfect. Have a seat. Now I'd like to call upon Dakota and Fawn with the Meshaki spirit to do the opening drum song. And I'd like to ask everybody to stand. For the opening drum song. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Ishtamingwaj to Meshaki Spirit, Dakota, and Fawn. Thank you very much for that, ladies and gentlemen. Now I'd like to call upon our elders, Terry and Barney. Please come on up for the prayer.
I just have to tell you, I was talking to Terry, and Terry and I have been doing work for the past number of years, traveling here, there, and what have you, and we usually do the openings as a tandem, man and woman, and we've been very successful at doing that, but she told me this morning, Barney, I got another job. She got offered a job as a cultural coordinator, and she took it. Can you imagine? Terry got a job. I couldn't believe it. But anyway, I think congratulations to her are in order for, you know, she's going to be a cultural coordinator. Great. Now, at my age, I wish I could find a job too. Anyway, I'll let Terry lead.
Good morning. I went to the teepee this morning. I went to offer tobacco and prayers to the sacred fire. I collect quite a few tobacco during the time that we work. People that need prayers, people that need just help, mental health supports, and a lot of times, people that struggle with challenges and losses, and we all go through that. And so this morning, all that tobacco that I've been collecting, I went and put it in a sacred fire this morning to acknowledge the prayers and to give Creator those prayers so that they may be answered. And we do a lot of that kind of work as elders. I just want to acknowledge today too that it would have been my late husband and I. It would have been our 54th anniversary today, and sometimes we have stories that we tell along with those events. And my anniversary didn't almost happen. My husband almost forgot our wedding day because he was always like us, working, traveling, and I guess he was driving on the highway and said, there's something today I should be doing. So I just wanted to acknowledge that. I just, you know, as Barney said, we do a lot of work together, we are asked to balance the gatherings by having us elders, male and female, man and woman, to offer our prayers each at each gathering. We do a lot at AFN and Chiefs of Ontario and, of course, Anishinaabe-Ashki. So we honor those requests, and we cherish those requests. And this morning is yesterday. I couldn't come yesterday. Second day at work. Thankfully, the organization that I work for is very lenient and very understanding of the other work that we do. So I'm glad to be here this morning. And so I just want to offer prayers this morning. And I thank Creator for being with us this morning. And you don't have to stand up if you don't. I always acknowledge people that pray the way you pray. You pray the way you feel comfortable praying. Kigi kinamago men gon chamanito che chiga gano nanget kinawent ma from our heart. So I'll start this morning with a prayer, and I'll say it in my language. I speak Ojibwe, and I also speak Ojikri fluently because of my marriage into Sandy Lake First Nation. That's my home. Miwe. Kananakuma min manito nongam gagashe bayak. Miigwech. Miigwech manito. Kananakuma nongam gagashe bayak. Gabachewa bandeshang waseya. Shoneaka migok. Ndigo atikndotem. Mikinak ndijion. Bejgo meteo. Kananakuma manito. En adam tago nongam gagishka gabach. Chaganwen mishang. Ekkendamang. Keen kinagagon, a kask toin a marking. Keen kinagagon egos toin a marking. Wegayabach toang, mitashejan and nakomegoin. Gabbage, chicken, gishoin chigan, majibito, and ego gishiwat, so neck can the mang, maoche sagishang. Mitashke, kagwech me goin. Tishoin the man oegawi, oega tochaga dig nongum. Kinagagon, tishoin dagok. Chimin Shiange, Kagita Tagusin, Kagita and the Mon, Mauch Mistehe, Epak send the monk, the Benon Tishmanana, where Kakinamo endua, Gabbage Bimadzon, Gajip Minja Mwat, where Kakinamagewin, Miwaj Gagwich Migo and Manito, where Gogamakana, where the Kiwetnung, Kat the Bendamwat. Kanakanaat at tansni mo ang gabit mskawasin jiminata ego ge ogoe kakinaw tanukig mskawasin jiminata ego ge minuayawin meja ka kwa chiminanong manito chimigwach migwach migwach
migwach migwach the just so that you know again we're looking at some learning experience, some hands-on stuff. When we do our opening, this is exactly what happens. Let's maybe it's another setting, and sometimes it's a highly political setting that we go to. So then my friend does her opening, which is so kind and so nice in her language, and there's beauty in that. And then what I do is I do a lot of research on the political end of it. And so I'm the person that gets up and lights the fire and really puts into place what I think is correct. And so it gets a little difficult, I do that. And so it creates for us a balance. It's a balance, and so it's a wonderful thing to be able to do that. And I hope my partner can still come around, although she has a job. But she said she will be allowed to travel, and I hope we can keep doing what we're doing for as long as we can, because it's so beautiful. And you know what? When you use the language, I was a director at the Friendship Center in North Bay, and my office was like here, and I could see out to the waiting room here. And this young lady coming from Manitoulin Island wanted to see our court worker who was upstairs. And two young ladies came. They were together. I'd picture them at about 14, 16 years old. But they were talking their language. And so, and this is the magic in the language. The one young lady told the other, and I could see them, I could hear them. And she said to her in their language, Kababi-ish, you wait for me. And upstairs she went. The other young lady sat there for about 20 minutes, maybe half an hour, and just sat there and waited till that other young lady came down. And what is in that is that when you say in our language, Kababi-ish, it's just not saying something like, wait a minute, wait a sec, I'll be back in a moment. Not like that. No, you wait for me. It's more like a command. Kababi-ish. So there's beauty in the language. And so it's a wonderful thing. And, you know, just picking up some catchphrases is really, really a good way to go. You know, like even if you use that, you know, to some of your students, kababi-ish, and get them used to that. Wait for me. I'll be there. Settle down, you know. That sort of a thing. So that's why I really appreciate when Terry comes, because she has a great command of her language. I have lost some of mine. I can still get along. But however, she's got great command of it. So I really, truly appreciate having her around. It's so, so good. And you know what? I think the passing of our elders, you know? It's sad, you know, when we see some of them gone now. And then when we think to ourselves, gosh, I should have used that person more. I should have paid more attention to that individual. You know, we need to use those people. And you don't know really where the hidden messages are. These people, for the most part, have something in their hearts and in their minds, something they can share with you. Maybe some secret that will help you with your work, you know. So we have to pay attention to that. We've lost a few in the past few years. And it saddens me when I think that all that knowledge is gone, you know. So we need to pay attention to that. But anyway, I thought hard, long and hard about yesterday. And, you know, just walking back and forth and talking to some of you individually. And I just come up with one thing. You know what? I just want to thank you for looking after our kids. I just want to thank you so much for that, for looking after our kids. When I was a chief, I asked, what should I do to my brother? And he told me, you should look after your kids. That's what you're doing. And you're doing a great job for us. And look, I know it's difficult. I know the pitfalls. I've been told. But overall, you're doing a great job for the chiefs, councils, and those that are out there. Good job. And thank you for looking after our kids. Thank you so much. Miigwech.
You know, I'm going to give them a new name. They're the BT Duo. Barney and Terry, thank you again for the prayers and the teachings and the words and stuff like that. It really puts everything into perspective of what we're doing over the next couple of days. And, you know, I really want to emphasize what Barney said. You guys are doing an amazing job as educators. When we see our kids, our students, walk across that stage to get their diplomas and stuff like that, that's just an amazing thing. I used to work at the high school in Fort Albany, and that was one of the greatest things to see, was our students walking across that stage and their smiles, you know, their accomplishments that they did, and it was just great to see. So ladies and gentlemen, we are going to continue on with our day today. Again, I'm not going to go verbatim on the agenda. You have the agenda with you. We have presentation, then we have the student panel, then we have lunch, and then we have the teacher panel right after lunch, and then we have another presentation. So bear with us today. We are going to have a great day of knowledge and learning, and I hope you guys are taking notes, and I hope you guys are especially networking. Our keynote speaker, looking 50 years into the future, an optimistic view of our languages. Patricia Nigmans is a Bear Clan from Lac Seul First Nation. She has spoken her language from childhood and taught it in universities all her adult life. She is currently the assistant professor at the University of Manitoba and vice president of the Indigenous Language Institute of Santa Fe, New Mexico. She assisted her grandson, Andek, to become the fluent speaker, and he's now teaching Ojibwe at the university level too. They're working on the new dictionary together. Her publishing company, Marnette Inc., has 14 books so far. Her son, Megan Linklater, grew up in Northern Ontario and is now the Director of Operations at Dakota Ojibwe Tribal Council. So, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Patricia.
Bonjour. Wabebejeki quendes nikas, maquando dem, I guess I'll have to stand. So what I'm going to talk about this morning is I'm going to talk about three things. My journey as a language teacher, translator, whatever I've done in the language. I'll not go too much into it because I want to talk about the block that we have from passing on the language to our families. And lastly, the 50-year plan that I have been working on. And that's what I really want to share with you because it's a very optimistic view of our language. So I'll talk briefly about my my work in the past. I grew up with my language. I was very lucky to be able to speak it. I went for 1 year to Pelican School in Sulakot, and that was horrible. But I was raised with my family after that in Hudson, Ontario, and where my family raised me. And later on, I went to Sault Ste. Marie to another residential school there, Shingwak, and that was more of a positive experience. During that time, I got to learn other dialects when I was in Sault Ste. Marie. People around Manitoulin, I got to learn their language over there. But I came back to Sulakot, and I worked for Wawate. I was the first editor of Wawate News at that time. And at that time, it was very exciting because the language was very vibrant in our area. And everybody spoke the language. At Lac Seul, I remember everybody speaking the language. Even the dogs could only understand our language. That's how good it was. Children could speak. And and then later, and then, so I worked in the language at Wawate because there was NNBAP funding at that time, Northern Native Broadcasting Access Program. And the purpose of that program was to help the languages stay alive because they were putting up satellites in the sky and to bring communications to the north. At that time, of course, the northern communities were isolated. There was no roads or telephones, no telephones at all, no electricity. It was really, you know, a different time back then. But everybody spoke the language, and that was good. And same with at Lac Seul, we didn't have any roads there, no electricity. So my job was to work with Wawate, at first with the newspaper, and then afterwards we got into TV production. And that was a really creative time because my job was to version films, documentaries. I translated them and then had them voiced into Ojibwe, and they were then aired after that. The rest of the crew did all sorts of programming. We did children's syllabic teachings, and it was a very good time. And of course, there was radio. Every community had a radio station, and the language was heard all day long, and that was really good. So, but I want to go back to when I was in Sault Ste. Marie, and further back, I want to acknowledge three people that have been very important to me. One is my grandmother, Gokum, Gokumiban, Maganat Gijan Kazo. And she was very very important to me because she lived with us, and she spoke English too. She was brought up for a few years by a Hudson Bay manager and his family, and they taught her English, and so she spoke English all her life, but only to white people. She didn't speak it at home. One time I asked her, Gokum, ani nwente mche shagan I nshnabem win I and dying. Why do you speak only Ojibwe to us in our home, even though you speak English? And she said in English, we're not English people. Kitan shnabem win sha I kitan shnabem win I kaun kino int shaganashak. So when she said that to me, it was such a powerful thing for her to say to me at that time. It made me very conscious of who I was, and the language that I speak should be my language. But it didn't help me still in passing it on with my family, and I'll be talking about that in a short while. The other person was my mother, who was a storyteller. She told stories, legends and stories. In the summertime, she'd tell stories about the Sioux, about Wendigo, about ghost stories, you know. She was really a good storyteller. And in the summer, in the winter, she told legends, all these, about over 30 legends that she told us, passed us, because we didn't have a TV. No electricity wherever we lived, so she was our TV. She would tell us these beautiful stories. The other person was my dad. My dad was he was of course self-employed. We were never on welfare, and he supported us by being a fisherman. And he always said to us, "You always do your best when you're working." Because if you do your best when you're working, you'll always have employment, and you'll go far if you do your best. And so with my publishing business, I think of him because he was a businessman himself. He did commercial fishing and buying fish and selling them. So with my book publishing, I think of him because I do my best with the books that I publish, and I do translation work too. So the translation money goes into the business, and it helps support the printing of the books. The books are really expensive to print. It'll cost sometimes $20,000. Sometimes even more if it's a book that requires a lot of work. You know, I hire writers and translators. So it's expensive, but I want quality. The very first book I ever printed was didn't have a shiny cover. It just had one color on it. Those were the days when I didn't believe yet that our books should be beautiful and should look as good as all the other books at the bookstore. I still thought that our books were over here, you know. All the other books are over here, but ours. Because everywhere I went at that time, books were usually beige or white or the covers or gray, and they had no shiny covers. These were books that were done by universities. And so our books looked so boring, and I thought that's the way they were supposed to be. But when you look at other language books at the bookstores, they were shiny, you know, beautiful colors. So eventually I got over that, and now my books are very beautiful. I have they're in color, and I brought some to give away after. but I think that our books are very, our language is very important, and it should be, you know, it should reflect that when you see it in the bookstore, that it looks as beautiful as other books. So at Tsinghua, I was there for 1 year. And 1 year, I was 14 years old, 13, 14. 1 year, there was a man that came to the school to talk to students. And he talked to me for about an hour. And that was Peter Kelly, the late Peter Kelly, the Psanquit. And when he was talking, we talked about everything. He could, you know, talk in a language with me, and a really high level of Anishinaabemowin. And I was so impressed. The things that he spoke of were so wise, just so, he could talk about anything. And at that time too, I was 14, I could talk about anything in my language. That's how fluent I was. I could talk about absolutely anything in the world, describe anything. I can't anymore because I've been living with English all my 70 years. And but I was different then. And listening to him, I thought, this is what university must be. To talk, to listen to someone who is very educated and wise. And every word is so beautiful. This is what university must be like. And it wasn't. I went to university and all I heard was English. And I really wanted to have an education in my own language, in my very own language. But that wasn't to happen. So anyway, I moved to Winnipeg, and I was able to get a job there where I was promoting, revitalizing the language in the city. I was very fortunate to work with elders there, and we did creative things like have a cable TV show in the city and have elders on as our guests, and I published my first book there. And we had language festivals to put on skits and plays. It was a really good job for 3 years until the funding ran out. something else I did at that time was to have a conference in Toronto to try to come up with one spelling system for all Ojibwes. The person that funded the program, the conference, was from Toronto, and he was had a very good vision of what our language planning should be like, and one that was to select one writing system that we all could use. So it happened for 3 days, and we had people from Quebec to Saskatchewan, Manitoba, Ontario, and even from Minnesota and Wisconsin. All the Anishinaabe that spoke the language, they came together, 200 of us. It was by invitation only, because we had to have a certain number from each area so that we wouldn't have all the people around Toronto come there and overpower everybody else. So we had equal numbers from across the region. And in the end, the conclusion we had was that the double vowel system that's used today is the one that's most widely used everywhere. So we chose that. We didn't choose it, we recognized it as the most prevalent system used. So I think that was a very important conference, you know, for Anishinaabe to get together. Another important thing I did around that time was to do a survey north of Sault Lookout of some 23 communities. There were seven of us that went and did door-to-door surveys of how much language is spoken, and among the adults and students. And at that time, it was roughly 85% of people that spoke the language still at that time, the 1993. And that was still, you know, okay. I did one for Shibogama about 7 years ago. And it was a much more pessimistic view. No children speak it. Very few young people can speak it. Even people in their 50s can not speak it that well, you know. So the language, English language media has really eroded our languages. It's really, that was not good to see that our languages are on their way out, you know. But now I'd like to talk about something that I've done last year. Last year, I was fortunate to participate in a 1 month, 4 weeks of immersion and in Winnipeg. We had 4 weeks of these students who did not speak English for 4 weeks. They lived together in a camp, and unfortunately, the camp was made for children, so all the beds were really short. The poor students, they had to, you know, sleep all kind of bent up. But they were so determined to learn their language that they put up with that. And so it was a really good program. No English at all. I had to teach them. And one student came in there. She couldn't even pronounce any Anishinaabe words. Not at all. Couldn't pronounce. At the end of 4 weeks, she was talking with everybody else. You know, she was conversing. She could talk, listen, understand, and talk. I was so proud of her. She put a lot of work into it, though. She put a lot in the evenings. They would all help each other with games and keep in the language. So in 4 weeks, these students were speaking the language at the end of 4 weeks. So I know we could do that with our students who don't speak the language. They need to be together learning for 4 weeks. And it cannot be an unstructured program. I take part in a two-week program in Minnesota. That one is unstructured. The students kind of, they hear the language 24 hours a day, but it's not structured, so they kind of have to just guess at what's being said, and they're not learning anything in a structured way. So my experience from the one in Winnipeg is that if there's an immersion program happening, it has to be structured. And in my experience of teaching, I believe that there's a path that the student takes, you know, to learn a language. There's a definite path. You can't just start off with, you know, numbers and colors and, you know, stuff like that. What kids are learning these days and not learning the language that way. There's a path, and that path is to start off with things that we say every day, you know, andeshayan, andegin, AI and Anishtigayan, all those things. Anishtigayan, you know, what's he doing? What are you guys doing? Anishtigayan, Kinoa, and Ninamatapmin, Wisnimin, whatever. Conversation, that's what they need to learn from day one, conversation. And the most commonly used things that we say, those are the things that need to be taught. And so you teach the grammar without saying, oh, this is a transitive verb, this is a intransitive verb. You don't teach that way. You teach it by the words that you're teaching, the patterns. And that's how you teach grammar, without discussing what you're doing. There are games I use in my language classes. One that I use a lot is Go Fish. And instead of just a deck of cards, I make my own cards and put the verbs in there to teach the verbs that we're doing that day, whether it's Niwabama, Ninundawa, Nimakama, anything to do with that kind of a verb. Or the other kinds of verbs are wisine, namatabe, pumose, you know, those kinds of verbs. Because we have different sets of verbs. So there'd be a different set of verb cards for that game, with those words, and another one for the other kinds of verbs, like I see him, I related to him, I know him. So, and we play Go Fish with those games. And it's really, it reaffirms what the students are learning. They can hear the words, they can say them. And so it's a really good game for learning vocabulary and also the grammar, you know. I'm very happy with that game. One night I was wondering, what should I do tomorrow? And then I came across this idea. And for you language teachers, you could use this, and that's to play baseball outside, okay? But instead of a real ball and a bat, you have your two teams, and the one that's pitching will have a phrase like, where are you going? You could flip it English or Ojibwe, depending what the answer you want. And so the person that bat, if he sees that andejayan, he knows that he has to say where he's going, you know. It has to be an appropriate answer. I'm going to the band office or, you know, some answer like that. So if he gets the answer, the appropriate answer, he gets to go to first base. Then the other one comes to bat. And if he doesn't get it, it's one out for that team. It's a really good game because the kids get to be outside and in good weather. And it's competitive. Kids like to compete with each other. And it's a good game. So I want to share that with you because it really worked for my adult students. So... How many are language teachers here, by the way? No? Nobody? One? Well, okay. But those of you who are administrators, do share that idea with the language teachers from your community, because it's a really good activity. So I want to stress that the course has to be structured. And I haven't attended this conference yesterday. I was in my room writing a book, my next book. It'll be the 15th book that I'm putting out. And it'll talk about that path that I believe that students must follow, you know. And it'll be based on that immersion course that we had. It'll be much like that. But I want to talk about briefly about the two new books. I have trouble walking too, so I'm glad he's going to help. These are the last two books that I have done. This This one here is called Reclaiming Our Territory Word by Word, and it's about grassroots language teaching. It's for anybody who wants to teach their language but doesn't know how to read and write in any system, and who doesn't know grammar, you know, what a transitive verb is and stuff like that. What it is a book of language lessons. So you could, and if you don't speak the language yourself, you could find a teacher, somebody that speaks the language, to help you learn a language. It's language lessons, and it has descriptions of activities that you could do to help you learn. And it's very low tech. You could take it to the bush and have language lessons there. So, and it's generic, so anybody could use it, Cree, Ojibwe, Ojibwe, Mohawk, whatever language you speak. And the other the book is called Ojibwe Thesaurus. And my colleague and I wrote this about 2 years ago in my backyard. It's doesn't have English in it. It's it'll have a word like flat, for instance. So, anything that's flat, it's in here. Nabaga, nabagapika, everything, you know, to do with flatness, even nabagitie. Flat bum. So it's really a fun book, you know. It goes into each word, like to eating, all the different ways that you eat, anything to do with eating, words are in there. So if somebody that speaks the language but forgets something, how's that word? They could just look it up here, and then they'll find that word, you know. It's a really good book. People tell me they enjoy it, you know. The thing we found was that to do with hitting or fighting, there were so many words, just about 100 words for hitting somebody, you know, different ways you could hit somebody. But for hugging, I think there were 3 words. What does that say about our So it's a very interesting book. I'd like to see a Cree version of that too, because it would be good for Crees to have that kind of a book too. So I'll be giving, I brought only 3 of each. I'll give away 3 at the end of my talk. Another thing I've done in Winnipeg is I've been able to pass on the language to my grandson, and I'm so proud of him. He speaks Ojibwe to me now. We talk about anything. We could talk at any level. And he's teaching university level now. When he was 19, he was hired by University of Manitoba to be a sessional lecturer, because there was nobody who would take that job. Nobody wanted to teach, you know. So I said, hire him. He knows the grammar. He can write. And so they did. And he got famous that year. They called him the teenage prof, because he was just 19, you know. He's in Duluth right now. But he finished his master's in linguistics. So he's on his way to doing something important. But anyway, I've made a promise to these 4 students, four, in Winnipeg, that I would help them become fluent. So we meet every Wednesday. I'll miss tonight. So we get together every Wednesday, and they're very committed, and we talk in a language. I ask them, so they'll talk about what they did, using the language that they know. And I really hope that in 2 years, they'll be fluent. I'll have created 3 new speakers. So any of you who speak the language here, please do that, you know. Take on some people to teach, not just your own children, you know, but other people, because we need people to speak the language, to learn it, you know. Because people my age, once I pass away, there goes my language, you know. So I want to pass it on to others. Which brings me to the topic of the conference that we're going to have in November. We're going to talk about the block, what I call the block. And it's the block we have here that was put there by the traumas that we experienced at residential school when people were really punished severely for speaking the language, and how that kind of set back our languages, you know. We don't say, oh, that's, you know, I stopped speaking my language because of what happened. We don't say that. It's just an overwhelming cloud that we have. We don't identify it, but we know that we don't value our languages as we should. When I'm at home with my brothers, they're my age, and my cousins, we don't speak in our language, except if we want to be funny. We speak in English, even though we can dunshnabimman. So nauchngichina damen che shaganashimwank. Sure, you could say, oh, it's easier to talk in English because then we could talk about computers and, you know, Netflix and all that. But we should be able to speak in our language even though we live in a different lifestyle. Because when I was 14, I could talk about anything. I remember being aware of that. I remember being aware that I could say absolutely anything, you know, even though we didn't have words for computer and stuff like that, you know. And it's not like that anymore. So we have this block. So in November, we're going to have a conference in Winnipeg. And it's only going to be by invitation and to Manitoba people, because that's our funding is from Manitoba. But I'll write a report about it and make it available to everybody else, so people in Thunder Bay could have such a conference, people from other parts of the country. I've been at conferences for, 40 years, and never have I ever heard that topic being discussed. I tried to talk about it at the ATEC conference one time in Sault Ste. Marie. People were crying in my workshop room. Young people were crying because they didn't learn it, language at home. They couldn't talk to their community people that spoke in Ojibwe. They felt shut out. They felt that they didn't belong there anymore because they couldn't understand what people were saying. They cried, and people my age were there too. They were crying too because they felt guilty for not passing the language on to their families. So there was a lot of crying in that room. And the organizer came in, she saw what was going on, and really angry with me. She said, we don't want to see this, you know. Don't do this again. Don't ever talk about what you're doing here. We're trying to move on. But it's we're just shoving it under the rug by not talking about it. We have to talk about that subject. It reminds me of when Phil Fontaine first talked about sexual abuse at residential school. He got criticized heavily too because he brought up a very awful topic. And I remember he went through a lot of dumping on by his own people. So I think we'll probably experience that with this block, because it happened to us, but we're not really talking about it. We're not acknowledging it. So at this conference, we're going to talk about it, and in the first day. And the second day, we're going to look at the solutions. What can we do? What have other people done in other countries? I talked about it in Spain last year at a language conference in Spain. And people, not just native people, but people who speak minority languages, they experience the very same thing, that block from being unable to pass it on. So it happens everywhere, not just here. Okay, now I'm going to talk about the 50-year plan, which I'm really happy about. And at the university where I work, my vice president of indigenous subjects, she asked me, write me a 5-year plan of where you want, what courses you want taught. I said, okay. So tried to write a 5-year plan. And it's 5 years can go so fast. I thought, this is not good. So I came across the idea of seeing 50 years from now. That's a long time. But not really, because 50 years ago, I was 22, 50 years ago. And the language was perfect in Sulakaut, at Lac Seul. You know, the language was so healthy. Now I go to Lac Seul, go home, nobody speaks it. Even the dogs. They only understand English now. So 50 years have gone, and it's not a good situation. So now I want 50 years vision. So the vision I have of our languages in 50 years is that there are sanctuaries. And we can't, of course, bring everybody speaking our language. We have to be realistic about it. So what I envision is sanctuaries for our language. Maybe a small city here, another small city, another part of the province, you know, and that no English be spoken within the walls of that little city. And in that city, maybe 5,000 people, that's about the size of Sulakaut, nobody would speak English. There would be schools all in the language taught by people that speak only Anishinaabemowin. There'd be a university. I get finally to have my university that's only in the language, where a person could get their BA, maybe graduate studies, and all the books that they use would be translated into the language. There'd be stores, restaurants, hospital done in the language. The doctors and nurses are speaking only the language to the patients, and everything is done in the language. Gas stations, everybody speaks it. So anybody that wants to learn, live in their language, they go and live there in a house. So that's what I envision. So how would we do that? How can we create that reality, make it into a reality? We have to work on it decade by decade. The first decade, right now, it's very crucial time, because people my age, we still live here. We still speak the language. So you have to make use of us. You have to have us write scripts for movies. we have to act in these movies because we still speak the language. There's a lot of us still, and we make them in our languages, Ojibwe, Cree, Ojibwe, whatever we have in Ontario. We make these in the next 2 or 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, because that's the only time we have to make this. We can't make them 40 years from now because we won't be here. So you have to use us today. We have to do that. The other thing is we have to modernize our languages, you know. a few weeks ago, I had a group of elders. We worked on computer terminology. We spent a full day modernizing our language by translating these computer terms, things like email, anything to do with working with a computer or your phone, your iPhone. It was eye-opening, very wonderful activity. So we need to modernize our languages so that people can not use loan words, English words, when we're talking. We have all these words that we make available for everybody to use. So that's the second thing. And the other thing is to create speakers, and that's to have 24-hour immersion programs where students are given a salary to learn their languages so they don't miss out on paying the bills and rent and so forth. They need to learn their languages, but not at their own cost. So we need to have immersion programs to create speakers. And no English at all. And I'm writing that book that takes you on that path from beginning to the end. I'm going to try to make it so that it's a handbook for students to use as they're learning. So those are the three things that I envision that have to happen. And during that, and in that sanctuary, there'd be movie theaters where people could see movies that are continually being made in their languages, in all different subjects, adventure movies, love scenes. We were laughing about that at another conference. They got all excited. Hey, I want to be in a love scene. no porn. But that would be fun to do movies like that, because we have so much creativity, our own people. We have our own humor, you know. And these things, these scripts would be done solely in the language first. We don't write them in English first and then translate them. You don't do that, because if you do that, you're only translating English thought. And we don't want English thought. We want our own expressions, our own humor to be in those movies, because that's where our culture is. It's in our humor, you know. Radio stations, there's so much we could do with radio. We could do music, we could do theater, translation of books. For the universities to function, there'd have to be constant translation of books, whatever new books are coming out, new knowledge. They would all be translated. So that would create employment for people that speak the language to continue translating, to continue creating these materials, to write novels in our languages. There's so much that could happen, you know, that there'd be an economy there, you know, just by creating. Right now we've got the commission, language commission, that's putting out money for to use in our communities. So I am hoping that that kind of money will continue in the next while, because we need our politicians to champion our languages and put them back up again to be number one again. It's too long that we've had them be second class. So those are the things that that I would like to see happen. You know, we really must see our languages put back on the number one again. You know, our languages should not be second class. That's our languages. We have no place to go to reclaim them. We can't go to Europe and look for Ojibwe over there. They're here. Our languages are here. Anishinaabemowin, Anishinaabemowin, Inanimwin, Kakina. And we have normalized English speaking so long that people think that English is it, you know. It's not. Our own languages should be it. Meganabach Minik Waikidwan, Chitashan Damanwe. I think this is what I'm gonna say. I'm kind of low key today because I just finished writing. And when I write, I get into this, you know. But thank you for listening, and I hope you take something back to your community about this this 50-year plan, this vision to make our languages alive 50 years from now, because that's where our grandchildren will be. We want our grandchildren to be living in the language, to know it. Help me, Gutch. So, I want to give these out, but I don't know how to do it. I gave out some copies in Duluth last month, 2 months ago. And so what I had was people who wanted a copy to come close, and then I threw them over my shoulder. And whoever catches one gets one. Oh, Beth. So the first one is Reclaiming Our Territory, word by word. Eh? I'm like, yes, I'm going to throw them. Yes. So I did this, and how? Number one. Oh. Next one. So be careful. Okay, the little ones. The little ones. Got it? Oh. Oh, no. You better come move it over. Last one. Okay.
I have to say that is the almost one of the very first times I've seen that. But that was actually pretty good. It got you guys going. Patricia, on behalf of Anishinaabeaski Best Practices Forum, we'd like to present you with a gift.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Do you need some help coming down? Or?
I'm okay.
You're okay? Okay. Again, one more time for Patricia, please. So I was... I was watching, when I was listening to Patricia, and Patricia made a very good point. My aunts and uncles, my cousins, they would always, when they get together, they were very fluent in their language, the Cree language. And it's, when she pointed out, the language is very funny. It is. It's funnier when you speak to another person fluently in Cree. And I know this for a fact because when I was younger, my aunts and my uncles would get together and they would laugh. It was just hilarious. Little small topics would become hilarious. And it just proves my point when Patricia said in Ojibwe, flat bum. Everybody laughed except for me, and that brought me back to when I was younger, when my aunts and uncles were laughing away, and I didn't understand them. But as I grew older, I caught on to those little phrases, the little words. And then as I got older, like an older teenager, I was able to laugh with them because I understood them. And it was funny. It was pretty good. Patricia, I forgot to ask you this question before you ran away. For the baseball game, now, how many phrases, minimum phrases, would you need? I know, like, there's, is it depending on the class size or... I'm sorry to, hold on, I want to. About 20 phrases? Now they're both Ojibwe and English, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Whatever they're learning?
Okay. So it doesn't have to be a specific topic or anything like that?
Whatever they're learning that day.
I think that's a very good idea. I love that idea. Not only you get to learn the language, you get physical activity. That's perfect. Thank you very much for that. Okay, so... Again, what we're going to be doing the next couple of hours or so, we have the student panel that's coming up, and we have three students for that, Jasmine, Julian, and Alexa. I'll be introducing them later. And then we're going to go into lunch. Then we have a teacher panel, and right after that, we have a trade show. So I encourage everybody, when you do get into the trade show, there's a lot of organizations in the lobby. So if you walk down the hallway, go towards the front desk, there's a lot of organizations and a lot of information to be had. So they have a lot of good goodies too. So if you have a bag or a purse or pack sack, whatever, just throw stuff in there, okay? All right? And it's free. So whatever's there, like what I do sometimes when I go to conferences, I'd like to take the pens off the tables. I use them for when I do facilitating workshops. I take the pens. I won't take any because I know you guys are educators. Yes?
They're not all free. There's a
roof
that's guys selling blankets.
So okay, yeah, that's true. Thank you very much for that. Yeah, there's actually somebody that's selling, so don't go stealing the blankets and stuff like that, okay? Okay, just a couple more things. Actually, I'm finished. Oh, yes, I actually have one more thing that I want to show you, and then I'm going to give you an early break, okay? And there's this... goes with Patricia, as she was saying. I have something here that I have kept with me, and it's close to my heart. And sometimes when I hear it, I get a little emotional. And I encourage this. If you have somebody that's fluently speaking, whether they're elders, they're adults, or anything, that's some of that, I encourage you to go out there and record them. Record them, talk to them, and just... have a conversation. Back in 2013, December 23 to be exact, I lost my granny. And 6 months before that, I was able to go visit her. And Madeline Edwards, Machinen, as we call her in Cree, I went to go see her. And for some reason, I knew, or the back of my head knew, that she was going to go on her spirit journey. But I didn't know it at that time. So what I did is I said, Kokum, that's Granny in Cree. I said, Kokum, I'm going to record you. Hey, okay. Mona, 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 mona. That's what she said. Mona, mona, mona. She was like, no, I don't want to. No. Mona, mona, gauna, gauna, gauna tuta. She said that. When we conversed with each other, she would speak to me in Cree. I would respond in English, right? And for some reason, we had this connection where we can talk to each other. And it was great. So the first time I said, okay, I'm going to record you to sing something or say something or whatever. And she said, she said in Cree, I don't want to. She got so like She didn't want to. And so she said, okay, Matiza, I'm going to do it, she said. So she went into her, she digged in her little bags that she has. My granny has like 13 bags around all the time. And so she went crawling, or she went to her bags, and she pulled out this book, this green little book, and it's a Cree hymn book, and had so many hymns in there. There was like hundreds. It was so perfect. It was, and so I put my phone down on the table, and I said, oh, Negamo. I don't know if I'm saying it right. Negamo, which is Cree, or singing Cree. So this is the first one. I'm not going to play the whole song. I'll just give you a portion, okay? But this is the first song that she sang. Can't make a liar out of me. What happened here? Is it not working?
I don't know. It's nothing over there. For now, can you just unplug it and play it through the...
Okay.
Or I can take it and I can plug it in over there.
Oh, okay. So... Okay, sorry about that. So I'm going to have to play it this way. But anyways, here it is. So that's the Amazing Grace in Cree. And it was so beautiful, right? It was so like, and then when she was finished, you should have seen her face. She was like, oh, Matamina, Matamina, Matamina. She got so excited and she was like singing. So I'm not going to play the whole song. I'm already shaking just listening to her voice. So she sang like maybe five songs. And then this is one of the best ones, though. After that, she was like, okay, I'm done now in Cree, right? I'm done now in Cree. But I'm gonna do one more thing, and then this is what she did. She said, I'm going to say the Our Father in Cree for you. And this is the Our Father. I'm not going to play the whole thing, but just a sample. So that's the Our Father in Cree, and I have that with me. And it's so cool. So I encourage you guys, like based on Patricia, go and have that conversation with elders or fluent people and record them, because you never know when you'll need it. So ladies and gentlemen, enjoy your break. It is now 10:16. Be back here at 10:30 with the student panel, and... snacks are over there. There's fruits, coffee and tea in the back, juice, water there as well. Again, I'll see you at 10:30, and we'll try to figure out why this thing is not working. Perfect. Perfect. Woo.
Check 1, 2. Jasmine Winters, Julian Beardy, and Alexa Sakic away, please come here to the front. Just got to run a few things with you guys. If you guys are here, please come here. All right. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, it's we're 2 minutes behind schedule. Uh-oh, you know what that means, right? That means a longer day by 10, 15 minutes. That's right. We're going to end probably about 4:45 now or 5 o'clock tonight. Okay? I am kidding. Come on, you guys know me. Okay, let's get started with the student panel. And I'm very happy that our four students, we have four students today, and I'm really happy that they're here today. And I spoke to them off to the side, and some of them are a little bit nervous. And I want you to encourage them as best you can. Okay, well, I'm going to call them up one by one. And they asked, hey, Brent, are we going to get up some walking tunes, walk-up tunes? And I said, yeah, why not? Let's do it. If you're feeling happy and awesome like that, that's perfect. That's what we're going to do. So let's get started with our student panel. Again, scream nice and loud. And let's start off with, let's welcome Jasmine Winter. Okay, let's welcome Julian Beardy. Julian Beardy, come on. Okay, let's go with Alexa Sagachowe. Hey, Alexa. And last but not least, let's welcome to the stage Andre McKay. You know what's weird? I'm playing 90s music and they probably never heard that song before. Yes, that's okay. Don't worry. So we're going to go down the line. We'll start off with Jasmine and we're going to work our way down this way. Okay. And we have a series of six questions we're going to ask them. And then we have a couple of warm-up questions we're going to ask them just to feel, get them to feel comfortable on stage here. Okay. And some speaking and stuff. So let's get started. So the first question, and Jasmine, you're going to start, and we're going to work our way down this way, is just please provide your name, your community you're from, your grade, and the school that you're currently working at, or going to school at.
Hi, I'm Jasmine Winters, and I'm from Wayagma Lake, and I currently go to KIHS.
Okay. Yeah, just grab, yeah, share microphones, yeah.
Hello? Okay, I did this yesterday too. Hi, I'm Alexa Sagatre. I'm from Yamatin First Nation. I'm a grade 12 student at Superior CBI.
Hi, I'm Andrew McKay. I'm from Sachko Lake First Nation, and I go to St. Ignatius High School in grade 10.
My name is Julian Beardy. I'm from Deer Lake. I go to DFC. I'm in grade 10.
All right, you guys. This is perfect. We're flowing already. Now, this is warm-up questions, okay? This is completely off the table. We just want to know your thoughts on this, okay? So the first question, remember, warm-up questions. Who is a better singer, Miley Cyrus or Taylor Swift?
Is it on? Oh. Hard decision. But I think I like Miley Cyrus. But I never betray Taylor, man. Never.
Okay. Yeah, just share your microphone.
I'm a Swiftie girly, so I'll go with Taylor.
All right. Miley then Taylor, okay? Perfect.
I definitely think Taylor.
All right.
I have no idea what anyone's talking about.
No, that's fine. That's fine. Okay, your next warm-up question, okay? If you could travel anywhere in the world right now, there's a plane, there's a limo outside, a hotel here, takes you to the airport in a private jet, where would you go?
New York.
Ooh, okay. That was pretty fast. Okay, good.
Australia? I would go Australia.
Okay.
What did I think about this one? Probably Hawaii.
All right, okay.
I would say that I wanted to go back to my hometown.
Oh, okay. Perfect. Good, good. And last warm-up question. Now, this is the serious one, and you're going to kind of explain your answer for this one, okay? All right. What would you choose, $10 billion or knowing the secrets of the universe?
Knowing the secrets of the universe, because then maybe you can sell the secrets for money.
Hey, okay. Okay. Okay, good.
I would also take the, what is it, secrets of the universe?
Yep.
I don't know. I feel like that would just be so cool.
Okay.
I would take the secrets of the universe because I'd rather have education over money.
Nice.
It's a hard thing to think about. If I had to choose, I'd probably pick the $1 billion.
Right on. $10 billion. That's perfect. For me, I would probably take the $10 billion and give money to my community and stuff like that so we can get an arena. Anyways. Okay, it's now time to get serious. We do have a series of six questions. There are four awesome, amazing students here. And the first question is, what kinds of things have you been doing to take care of yourself, i.e. visiting family, friends, activities, or whatnot?
I've been going for, like, rides, like, on a vehicle in my reserve, or going on a ski-doo and going for a ride on the ice, and going for bonfires with my friends, and playing volleyball with them.
That's good. Perfect.
I like to go on walks. They're my favorite things ever. I love going on walks. Even when it's cold out, I try my best to make time for walks. There's this particular path along between the university and the college, and it's not lit up, which, okay, just should be a concern, but I I love walking that path, like, during the night, because then it's just like, you know, the trees, they be singing to me, and the wind be blowing. And I just love going on walks.
Personally, I choose playing hockey with friends. So I can meet new people, keep myself busy, keep myself active and healthy. That's all.
I like to visit my friends and family from time to time. I also like doing a couple of my hobbies. They're playing. Drawing and knitting. I also work out at least once a day.
Awesome. Those are very good activities, you guys. Those are very good to relieve that stress that you guys could be having. All right, your second question here is, what advice would you give to teachers in the audience that are here today about teaching First Nation students?
Probably to be understanding and patient, because some students may be going through a hard time with something, or, you know, not feeling comfortable in some place that they're in, especially if they're new to high school and they come out for high school.
Alongside that, I would say Indigenous students definitely need more support than non-Indigenous students. Like, yes, our non-Indigenous students need support, but for our Indigenous students, it's a necessity. And it's not just within school supports, we need outside supports. Like, we need people to care about us. We need people to listen to us. And I would just say, you gotta go that extra step for your Indigenous students, because for so long, they haven't even gotten the first step from these people who are supposed to educate them. You know, they've been facing barriers from these people who are supposed to educate them. So as an educator today, what really you could do is go more than the surface level step for an Indigenous student, but rather take multiple steps to say, I am here to support you as a student, but also as a person.
That's amazing. Thank you very much for that.
I let them know that some people can go through more than others, and not everyone works at the exact same pace, so you have to take your time getting to know the students one by one.
Just have some cultural awareness and have an understanding of people's backgrounds. Students need that student to teacher connection. Getting to know people on a personal level will help people get through life. Also, you should have an open mind and a willingness to learn from each and every student.
I hope the teachers and educators, I hope you guys are taking notes, okay? This is awesome. This is good to learn from our students. And you know what? I really want to ask you guys, let's give them a nice round of applause, because they are, you know, they're speaking their mind, and this is what we wanted. This is exactly what the student panel is for all our educators, no matter what. We always learn from our students, no matter what age they are, they will teach us something. So I'm really glad that they're up here. Thank you again. So your next question. I would like you to think about a teacher you really like, and what is the one thing they said or did that made a difference for you? Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
My teacher, or I don't know. No, she's not my teacher, but we were talking before, just like a normal conversation, and she was like, "Nothing is guaranteed," and like that really stuck to me, because like that means I have to work harder and work smarter for the things I want, because nothing is guaranteed.
Oops, my bad.
So I had to think about this for a while. I was sent the questions, and I genuinely thought about this question. I was like, I don't think there's one particular moment or interaction with a teacher that I've had which has made an impact. I think it's, as was said previously, it's about the connections that you make with the teachers that make the most differences, and it's about those teachers who truly believe in you, you know, as a person, as a student, as an Indigenous youth. So I would just, yeah, it's having teachers who believe in me is what really changed a lot for me.
One thing an adult in my school told me was, make sure you work on your mental health before you start like working on schoolwork, so you stay more mentally healthy, so you could stay on top of your schoolwork without being stressed out with everything going on.
I wouldn't say just one teacher was influential at all, but all teachers are important for each and every student having that connection. And having people to guide them is important for everyone to be their best.
You know, when I was listening to them, I had to write down a few things, because I think each and every one of us in this room, we all had that influential person, that influential teacher. And I think we all remember what they said. Mine was Miss Bernie from grade 5 and grade 7 and 8 class when I was back in Moosonee Public School. And I'll always remember two professors of mine, Deb and Mike McCabe. Mike McCabe always said, be 8 hours smarter than the average bear. That's what he said. And Deb always had three things. She said, always have the voice, the look, and the stare. But yeah, those are my ones. I just wanted to throw that in because I thought that was an important question. Our next question. Tell us about your experience transitioning from community elementary school to secondary school.
It was like kind of weird, even though I expected it to be, because like I had my own space. Like there was like a wall right here and right here, and I got to like, it was on paper. I was doing my work on paper. Then all of a sudden I was doing it on computer, which was really confusing. But I think I have the hang of it now. It was kind of hard at first, but it's easy. Just kidding.
My transition between elementary school and secondary school was, oh my God, I'm shaking. Oops, I should not have done that. I'm doing great, guys. I would say my experience was definitely more smoothly. I fortunately have family who live in Thunder Bay, and I live with my mother, so I'm able to be supported by my immediate family. So I would say my transition was particularly smooth in, you know, comparison to those who may not have such a, privilege to be with family, even though it shouldn't be a privilege, but rather a right. So that was just my experience. I was very much supported through my transition.
My transition from elementary school to secondary school was more stressful, as there's like loads more new people I'd meet, and there's just more problems of like school working as it got harder when you get older. And like, I don't know, I was more lucky as I had my family here with me, had some friends, just I was involved with multiple activities. I say it was not as hard as some people, as other people. Oh, that's all.
My experience went pretty smoothly. I get homesick every now and then. And learning how to navigate the Thunder Bay from being in the small town to a bigger town, I should say, has been difficult. I barely even know the route to my school, but I get rides myself, so I'm lucky enough to not have to worry about that too much.
Awesome. This is really, yes. Thank you for that, guys. And I want to ask the audience here, if you can, prepare a question or two, okay, that you would like to ask the students, because we have the students here, they're available, and I'd like to get, it's very important to get their thoughts and their ideas about any specific topic that's happening in the schools or anything like that, okay? I'm going to go off the board again. Okay, I'm going to go off the board, guys. And there's a question that I would like to ask. And that question is, if you could be famous for anything in the world, okay, if you could be famous for anything in the world, what kind of famous would you like to be and to be known for? Yeah, if you could be famous, for instance, for me, if I wanted to be famous, I would be known to be the greatest hockey player ever and to play for the Toronto Maple Leafs. That's my famous. That's what I would like to be. But I would like to see you guys. What would you like to be famous for? How about this? Let me. Okay. How about this? I'm going to say, ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Jasmine Winters. And then you're going to say, well, I'm famous for, and then you're going to tell us, okay?
Okay.
That's what we're going. That's how we're going to introduce us, okay?
Oh my goodness.
Again, I'm just making our students comfortable. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage, Jasmine Winters.
Hi, I'm Jasmine. I'm famous for race car driving.
Yay! Okay. All right. Now, Jasmine, would that be F1 NASCAR or what?
Is there the fastest?
Okay, perfect. Up next, up to the stage. Welcome to the stage, Julian Beauty.
Hello, my name is Julian Beauty. I would want to be known for advocating for my students and peers.
Nice. All right. I like that one. Up next, bring to the stage Alexa Sagachue.
Hi. I would like to be famous for comedy. I think I'm a very silly little girly, and I love making jokes, and I love laughing.
All right. Okay, good. Okay. And last but not least, welcome to the stage, Andre McKay.
Hi. I'd like to be famous for playing sports such as hockey. Get out there and known by the world.
All right, okay, good. So we have a race car driver, we have a famous facilitator speaker, we have a race hockey player or athlete, and Alexa, which one was?
Comedy.
Oh yeah, comedian, famous comedian. Yes, there you go. Okay, let's get back to seriousness now. Okay, all right. So the next question I'd like to ask you guys is, what's one issue that you feel Indigenous students face today that is important to you that teachers should be aware of?
Indigenous students mostly go through loss from with their friends and family more than an average person should. So honestly, I think there should be more support in schools and checkups for Indigenous students and other students too, because you never know what they feel or don't feel.
So I interpreted the question differently. I am coming from an education standpoint. So, and I also had multiple answers. Sorry, you guys are just going to hear me talk for a bit. But
no, that's perfect. That's perfect.
I would say a particular difficult. Oh, let me get the question back up.
Did you want me to repeat?
No, I haven't.
Okay. Okay.
Within the schools, I feel Indigenous peoples are not represented within the curriculum or not represented with wellness in the curriculum, and I feel like that definitely, with already dealing with so much, Indigenous students now think of themselves even less because of how they're represented in the curriculum. So positive representation would be great. And, even to take that extra step to, as an educator, to take that extra step to be like, this is how it's written in the textbooks, but this is not how Indigenous peoples are. This is not, in the textbooks, they are written as these savages and these people who created grief, but in reality, they are the people who are feeling grief. They are the people who experience grief in their everyday. So going that extra step to say, this is what's in the curriculum, but it is not necessarily what is the truth. And then finding a space to exist within colonial spaces and colonial institutions such as schools. It's so hard to exist as is, but now you're putting a young Indigenous person in a space that systemically was not built for them, systemically was built to be against them, systemically was built to erase them. And so it's very difficult to find spaces where you can just let yourself exist and let yourself, exist as an Indigenous youth within these schools. And I know within the Catholic and the Laika District School Board, there are four direction rooms, and I think that is definitely a step forward. However, I will say, it is very difficult when it comes to this is an Indigenous safe space and this is the room for Indigenous peoples. I find that a lot of these places, like when you walk in for supports, it's like, oh, like they're gonna go and get supports, they're gonna go and get, you know, it's for Indigenous peoples, it's kind of looked down upon. So I feel like what would be beneficial for, you know, frontline workers such as educators to do would be to positively promote these spaces and positively promote Indigenous students and Indigenous peoples every day. You know, it's like, oh yeah, hell yeah, that's a space for Indigenous peoples, and not that's the space for Indigenous peoples. Because I know I've really benefited from those kinds of spaces and those kind of people that I've met within those spaces. And yeah, and I think another thing is that for educators to understand within the schools is that it can be very hard to step into class. I know I find difficulty stepping into class because in that moment I'm leaving my Indigenous safe space to go to class. I'm leaving my Indigenous safe space to enter a colonial space. So it's a very difficult transition for me to make, even as a grade 12 student. And I do need support to make that transition, even though it's a 2-minute transition within the day. It's a difficult transition, and I think it would be important for educators to know that it is a difficult transition, you know, because some of our students, they come from up north, and that is a very difficult transition in itself. But these students continue to face difficult transitions even in everyday, such as leaving their Indigenous safe spaces to enter colonial spaces. So, I don't know. Just be more understanding when a student, an Indigenous student, shows up late. Because it's not just, oh, this student is not coming to class and not coming to class on time. It's this student is facing a barrier because they know that they are walking into a space that was built to not welcome them. And yeah, I'm gonna keep talking, so I'm gonna shut up now so that we can end on time.
We have plenty of time, so you know I'm not going to stop any of you students. If you guys want to share anything, any thoughts, and if you even want to go beyond the question, I mean, by all means, go for it. Okay, let's continue on with Andre.
I'd like the teachers to know that the Indigenous youth are also affected by generational trauma passed down from the older generations of Indigenous people, as they were affected with residential schools, as they coped from that, with not all were able to heal, and they passed down trauma to the new generation of the youth. Indigenous youth, if they're coming from their communities is a safe place for them, as they, once they move to a bigger city, they're in a new environment, new school, new rules, different society. They just have to be more safe out here, as they can be targeted by racism more than anyone else. And that's all.
Perfect.
I feel like we all share the same sentiment as the fact that we have to grow up and live in a world that wasn't made for us. How different each and every Indigenous student lives can be, from having a stable life to all the ups and downs everyone can have. All of the students should be able to have a safe space to be, practice their cultures and traditions. Even the people who weren't able to because of their rocky past. Everyone should have a safe space to be.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for that. Okay, so your next question is kind of leading towards your ideas. And the other, the next question after that, well, actually, let's just focus on one question at a time. So your next question is, tell us a goal you would like to accomplish and how you will be able to accomplish that. So a goal that you have in mind in the future, with, let's say in the next 3 years, 5 years down the road, and how do you think you're going to accomplish that goal?
Can it be like anything?
It could be anything you want. That one of your personal goals that you have. And then we have a lot of educators here that will say, okay, we can help with that, we can help with this, we can do this. But how do you think you would accomplish that goal?
I'd like to be a mental health worker when I, you know, when I'm old. Just kidding. Sorry. I'm just kidding.
Old is just a word, just letting you know.
I could start by, like, taking the courses it's needed for the job I want to do. I can also learn more by searching it up. I can also help some of my friends when they need it, which I already do, because I'm so good. Just kidding. But yeah, I think that's what I can do to work towards my goal.
Awesome. Okay.
Goals? Oh God, I do have a goal, and I think my more prominent goal right now is to graduate. I'm a grade 12 student, so hopefully I only have 3 months left. I need to get out of here, guys. I would just graduate, and I think for the past 3 years, I've had people who have supported me, and I think for my rest of 3 months that I have at my high school, I think it's just important for me to continually access my support people and those people who believe in me, like Anika, I love you. And yeah, I think a large part of my educational journey, I've been able to make it because of those people who have supported me. And so I think the continual support for the next so months will help me get, you know, to help me actually graduate. That's so crazy, guys. I'm getting old. I mean, I don't know. It's exciting. It's nerve-wracking. And I really hope I get to graduate. Oh, also, I hope I do good in my classes. I should probably study. I did an English test yesterday. I think it went really well. But yeah, studying, accessing my support people is what's going to help me graduate.
Awesome. And I just want to remind you, old is just a term, okay, guys? All right?
A goal I have in mind is to, like, graduate from university, maybe. I could do that by upping my grades so I could get into a good university, talk to my parents about what I want to do with my life, just follow the path from school, talk to my teachers about it, learn what I could do, and that's all.
What I want to do is just, I want to help people. But for now, I'm focusing on my fellow students and peers. Being up here, being able to speak on behalf of everyone, every student, is really nerve-wracking, honestly. But it's helping me be able to speak out for my own, my fellow students and peers. I'm also working with the RMYC, the Regional Multi Youth Council. It's given me the chance to give safe places for students, and the student council and DFC. I've been able to organize events, talk on, introduce special guests, and help my peers over at the DFC have a fun time during the years that might be a bit rocky for them.
All right, that's awesome. Now, just to let you know, students, we are actually online too as well. Then we have a question from online. Let's go with Michelle Sandberg, who is watching online, and to the millions out there, what Jay Bojou? No, I'm not even sure how many people are watching, but they are watching us, and they're listening to your answers and, you know, learning from you guys. Also, this is a question from Michelle Sandberg. What changes in the school system would help you the most? So there's a lot of, what would you like to change in the school system? Would it be like the policies? Would it be the classroom, the curriculum? What do you think would help you the most?
Probably doing more activities with classmates. So like mostly hands-on things, like teamwork things. So like people don't get shy. Mm-hmm. Kidding. But yeah, I think teamwork things, hands-on, stuff like that. Oops, sorry guys. Okay, are you ready?
Okay. Could you re-question the question?
Yeah,
the question is. Can you restate the question, please?
Yeah, no problem. The question is, what changes in the school system would help you the most? So in terms of like policy, the classroom, the setup, it could be the curriculum, disciplinary actions, support systems. What would you like to see change? What would help you the most? Yes.
Okay. Well, I'm just leaving, but something that I would like to see is definitely curriculum changes. I would love for the curriculum to be indigenized, and you know, I would love history to actually be history and not just white history. I love for like art to explore indigenous art too and indigenous artists. And I know we have, I forgot the letters, NBE3 English, which is a understanding contemporary voices of First Nations, Métis, and Inuit voices as a is a mandatory class for grade 11 students. And I think that's definitely a positive within the recent years. But I think having, you know, that activism and those changes continue would be great. And I would love, for more supports. Indigenous students need those supports. You know, it's a necessity for Indigenous students to have constant, you know, accessible access to supports and to those peoples and, you know, to spaces that accept them and work for them and not work for against them. And I think something else I would love to see is accessible elders within schools because schools can be so daunting for Indigenous peoples and so scary to be in. Having, you know, the support and the knowledge of an elder would be amazing. I would love to see that, guys. And what else? Wait, what other examples did you give of policies? Ooh, I love for more cultural sensitivity to be required for educators. And, you know, what's the word I'm thinking of? Resources for educators to, you know,
figure out what is appropriate and inappropriate to teach if I'm teaching Indigenous courses or like Indigenous study courses or the Indigenous English course. And I'd love for Indigenous knowledge to be taken as knowledge within the school, you know, within school curriculum, within the policies and by educators, by administrators. I'd love for, because our knowledge is knowledge, and the way the system works, it questions that. And I think it should not be questioned that, you know, it should be just as valued as any other knowledge, because it is just as valuable. I will give a brief example. Is I had tried to pick an Indigenous book, like a book by an Indigenous author for my English class this semester. And I quite literally had to fight my teacher. We went to the back, we punched it out, and no. I beat her up so good, guys.
Okay, let's not state the violence part, okay?
No. But I had like ongoing emails with her for a few, like 2 days, yeah, trying to get her to let me read this book. And eventually I was just like, no, I'm reading this book whether you let me or not. Like, this is my education, I'm taking charge of it, and I need this, you know. It's something so personal to me, where it's like I need to be able to have these resources and have this knowledge. I'm going to use this book for my education, whether you like it or not. And I think, so that was an instance where Indigenous knowledge was not as valued, and it needs to be valued. And I should not have to fight my teacher to let me read a book by an Indigenous author. That should not be an issue. And, you know, when in that instance, I think about as well the students who may not have the skills or the advocacy skills to advocate for themselves in that situation, where they're not led to take charge of their education and, you know, put a little Indigenous twist on it, although education is Indigenous anyway. What have I been... See, this is why you should not... Sometimes I talk and I just keep going. Someone needs to stop me eventually. Okay, what else? Actually, no. I'm gonna call this, I think. No. Anyway, so having supports, indigenizing the curriculum, and accepting Indigenous knowledge as knowledge and as valuable, you know, in the mindset, having that mindset where it's just as valuable as any other knowledge needs to be supported within schools and within the school systems.
Thank you, Alexa. That was awesome. And I just want to emphasize, yeah, give her a nice round of applause, please. I just want to emphasize what Alexa said, and I think that's very important. And if there's any school board leadership here, or all the educators, I think when she pointed out that elders being in the school, that is very important. It not only brings the teachings, you know, but it brings the importance of respect. When you have an elder around, we have that respect for them. And that resonates not just with just the classroom, but it resonates the entire school. Because when you see an elder, you see respect. So that's thank you very much for Alexa for that. Okay, let's continue on with Andre.
Can you repeat the question, please?
Yeah, no problem. What changes in the school system would help you the most?
Something that would really help me the most is providing more help after school. Something that really helped was when I was struggling in my math class, my math teacher took his own free time to teach me after school, catch me up on work, worked with me one-on-one at my own pace because he knew I was going through a hard time. He just worked with me one-on-one, made sure I knew what was going on in the class. And something else that would help is occasional check-ins on students who are struggling with work, see if everything's okay going on with them. Because I know some youth they have problems reaching out for help when they're struggling. So they'll need someone to go check in on them. And that's all.
Thank you, Andre. Thank you very much for that. And Julian.
It just feels like there should be more focus on, with the government, there should be more focus on school. Because in the smaller towns up north, just, or basically just everywhere, sometimes aren't able to get in proper education. At my hometown, the bus broke down for way too long. My little sisters were out of school for so long. And it's way too important for continuing just life. Having an education, and proving that you're capable. It's way too important to have ignored.
Thank you, Julian. Thank you very much for that. Our next question, we're going to go back to the script now. Here's the next question. In what ways would you like to see Indigenous cultures and traditions integrated into the curriculum?
Probably more Indigenous art, need to learn more about it and do some, because when I did my art like that, I actually pretty enjoyed it, but I wasn't that good. Just kidding. But hold on, I can find it. We should have more teachings about smudging, powwows and stuff like that, and bringing in elders to share stories and their beliefs and what it was like before Christianity was introduced to them, in the reserve, because, you know, it used to be different.
Okay, so I would like to see, again, you took my answer, I had Indigenous art as the first thing, but whatever.
I'm sorry.
I think any subject could, what's the word I'm thinking of? I think any curriculum, whether that's the math, science, history, art curriculum could benefit from viewing it through an Indigenous lens, at least sometime through the curriculum. And I know we spoke about it yesterday, about how beading can be secretly math for some students. And I think particularly I'll say through history, because that's one that is most prominently erasing Indigenous lenses and Indigenous peoples. I would love to see, the truth act be represented within the curriculum. And for here, I don't know, okay. I can't understand my notes now that I'm looking at them. what is this? Okay. Oh, Anishinaabe classes and native language classes, particularly within high schools, be, for them to be able to be used towards post-secondary, because right now, the way that the language classes are is that they're at an open level and not a U or M or C level, which would be university mixed or college. And I know that's a barrier that I faced, is because I took Ojibwe for 3 years and I wasn't able to use any of those credits towards post-secondary. And I think, those are my favorite classes, and those were definitely the classes where I had pretty high grades. And so it was disheartening to hear. I was like, oh, my hard work and, of taking a class where I truly believed in what I was learning and I was truly proud of what I was learning could not be used towards
post-secondary education, and I think that that's a large barrier that I faced, particularly within education. And then my phone turned off, so now I can't read the question. Yeah, I think those are just a few of my recommendations, but I don't want to, again, I don't want to take up too much time, because once I get talking, I talk. It's a big flaw of mine, but it's okay. I'll move it on.
Alexa, I just want to let you know, when you're on a student panel, or any panel for that matter, or if you're invited to speak and there's educators or professionals out there, don't feel bad about talking long. Don't feel bad about getting your point out there, because this is very important. You know, I don't know if you've noticed, but when you're talking and when the others are talking on the panel here, I've noticed that heads go down. And that tells me that they're taking notes of what you said. And that's very important. They take that information, it's either for themselves, or they'll share it with their superiors, their supervisors, their bosses, or maybe even the other people. So like I said, don't ever feel bad if you're talking long. Don't ever feel bad if you feel like you only said a few words. Don't ever feel like that, okay? Because it's very important of what you're saying right now. Everybody here is going to respect you for that, okay? So let's continue on. Andre, I want to point out, I'm very, very, very happy of all these four individuals right now. You know why? Because they're very prepared. I see notes, I see them writing stuff down, and I seen them beforehand during the panel. They had stuff prepared. And I love that. Let's give them a nice round of applause again. Come on, our students are prepared. That's awesome. Okay, let's continue on with Andre.
Something I'd like to see more schools incorporate is having a cultural room that Indigenous students can go do work in. And if they're having problems with the class environment, they could just ask to go to a cultural room, like, so they could have a more comfortable space to do their work, more quiet, and it's more like welcoming. As my cultural room at St. Ignatius, there's a Ojibwe wheel, and there's just a bunch of artwork everywhere, and there's a canoe in there too. Just more like feels like home there. And you could also provide activities like Indigenous artwork, or you could have like elders come in and share knowledge with the students. Just make us feel more welcome in the school.
Thank you very much for that.
One of the things I'd like to see is more elders teaching young people. Having that guidance is also important. And along with everyone else said, having a safe space to practice your culture and traditions is really important for everyone. And integrating indigenous aspects, such as using indigenous authors for book study in English, and having more culture-based class to learn about their cultures.
Thank you very much for that.
Oh yeah,
go ahead. No.
I was just saying, I can finally understand the piece of my note that I couldn't a minute ago, because it's just two words, and I was like, what am I trying to say? But this was particularly for history, because as Indigenous peoples, we share our stories through a circle, and I think when you're teaching Indigenous history, although it's underrepresented within the curriculum, when I think it would be awesome to have that space transformed into a circle. And I think any class space could benefit from a circle. I think circles are so powerful. I love circles, and you know, welcoming in elders to tell their stories and to tell their truth, because again, you know, to understand of our history, you got to hear the full truth and the hard truths that are going to hurt to hear, but you know, they are our truth as Indigenous peoples, and they're the truth of the non-Indigenous peoples within Canada as well, because, you know, we come from the same land. Well, maybe not the same, but we reside, I'll say, now on the same land and with each other. So, you know, circles, elders, in history.
Thank you, Alexa. Thank you very much. You know, we took a couple of questions from the people that were watching online. So, hello, everybody online. And now I'd like to ask if anybody from the crowd, from the audience here, would like to ask a question. By all means, come up or just yell it out, and then I'll kind of repeat it for you, for the students. So if there's any questions, yeah, right in the back over here.
Yeah, I did an Ojibwe course when, I don't know what that was, but it was this year, because I'm only in grade 9. I forgot to say that before. but, wait, what is your question again?
I'm just wondering if you're able to keep your language alive, whether it's Ojibwe or Ojibwe throughout high school. Because I know, and I think Alexa was mentioning that, you know, there's no UNC, it's an open level course. So I'm just wondering if you're able to still have those opportunities to keep your language.
There's also other languages, I think, more courses, but yeah, I think I'm able to keep it alive because I come from an Ojibwe community, and like I already speak some words because of my parents, right there, so those are my best friends, and my other family. And most of my friends call me all Riz because I speak Ojibwe around them. It's kidding. But yeah.
Okay.
I would say the open level courses, which again, you know, could be mixed, have a different. What am I trying to say? No.
Opportunities.
Yeah, they could be used to. Okay, you know what? This thought just went out of my brain. Anyway, I would say that these courses have been my first and seemingly only opportunities to be able to learn the language, and I definitely, you know, appreciate getting this knowledge through school and through something that's essentially free for me. Woo! But I would say it's very difficult, especially within high school, because you're in a space, obviously, that's systemically and historically doesn't welcome the language to be spoken. And so it's like, oh, it's kind of nerve-wracking to speak it out of the classroom, because I know for my classrooms, it's been small classrooms, all Indigenous students, and so it's just like, hey guys, what's up? And you know, and those are the spaces within the schools where I've felt comfortable in. But stepping out of the classroom, it's a different space because historically it hasn't been a space for Indigenous peoples. Though I do think, yes, having these courses are fantastic, and they promote learning the language, and they promote keeping the language alive, and they should continually be promoted for students. But I just think it's difficult within the school community outside of the classroom to be open to speak the language. And yeah, but I would say these courses do have value to me you know, I value these courses. These are the classes where I've put in the most work in. I'm super passionate, and I wish so badly that these grades could be reflected for my post-secondary applications, but unfortunately, because they are open courses, they are not, you know, working through these classes, I've been very passionate about them because it is about keeping the language alive. It is about spreading the language and continually, because speaking it is what keeps it alive, and there's no doubt about that. But yeah, I would say, anyway, in conclusion, it is very difficult to keep it alive because of how historically the systems have worked, but it is amazing that these opportunities are offered and, you know, that it's available for students. And I wish, again, it could be used towards, I wish, like, these courses could be used towards other opportunities, because most of my friends who are Indigenous, they take these courses and they feel the same way, where it's like they've put the most work into these classes because they're the most passionate about keeping the language alive. And it's unfortunate that our passion for our language cannot be reflected in pursuing other opportunities. Yeah.
Thank you, Alexa. Thank you very much for that.
I'd say, like, keeping the language alive throughout all these years could be difficult with all the other stuff going on with school. Like, Ojibwe class or OG Cree native language classes aren't prioritized by school board, but it should be. As, like, the youth need to learn their cultures, learn their language, but it's something that isn't, like, prioritized by a school board. We could support native language classes, but that's only like one period a day. It's something that it's hard to keep alive with everything else going on. That's put ahead of class.
Thank you, Andre. Thank you very much. And Julian.
Let's say we do have the opportunity over at DFC. We are taught by an elder, I think. It's one of our courses. But having so much of the population speak English is probably one of the reasons why it's going to be difficult to learn and keep the language.
Okay. Oh. Thank you for that question. We're going to take one more question from the crowd. Ooh, there's so many hands that just went up. Okay, you know what, Julian? You pick who's going to take the question. Who's going to ask the question? There's a couple of people there. Just point to who do you think? Who would you want? Okay, Andre, pick somebody that's going to answer or ask a question.
The one smiling away.
Okay.
I do want to give you guys a gift, so I was hoping you would pick me, because I think it's nice. Very courageous. It's very courageous of these guys to come up and share their stories.
Just kidding. So my question, it's not really a question, how would you support other students coming in into your school who are apprehensive, nervous, scared? How would you support their being, their mental health and that? Miigwech.
That is an amazing question. Just to sum up what she said, you guys are now in the older grades, right? You guys are grade 9, 10, 11, 12, right? Now, she's referring to the question is, how would you support somebody that's coming into the school that's very new, and how would you support that student?
I would probably give them advice, provide them with information that they need for high school. Because some people did that for me, and it was like nice to have, and it was nice to have talks with them. And I think if we could have talks with the grade eights that are coming into high school, I think they'd have a more understanding of like security or something. I don't know. I have a lot of words in my mind, but I just can't seem to get it out. Like, I wish I could project it.
No, that's good, though. Advice is really good, though. Thank you for that.
I would like to, I'd like to do two things. I would, first of all, like to give them like a rundown, just like heads up. Like, you're about to face some things that you may have not, that you are not prepared for. You know, you're gonna experience more than, it's not just school for Indigenous youth, and I would love to be able to share that with Indigenous youth who are coming into high schools. We're like, I think it's a battle. It's something that Indigenous youth have to fight for every day, is their education. And so I would like to just give them a rundown. Be like, hey, girly, by the way, am I allowed to swear? I'm just really, by the way, shit's about to go down. So, you know, and thus with that, I would also like to, you know, offer them the supports that I've been able to receive, you know, the people that who have helped me and be like, hey, by the way, this is so and so's phone number. Just let them know, you know me. They'll get in contact. Like, yeah, I would love to give them like a rundown of what they're about to face, because it is scary, and it's hard, and it's difficult to do every day, and it's exhausting to do every day. So, and I would also, yeah, give them the supports that have helped me in particular, or me personally, that's a better way to say it. Yep.
Thank you. Andre?
Something I'll do is, with the new student, I'll tell them about educational resources, be there for them, just give them a friendly face to talk to once. Like, if they're alone, you could go talk to them if they're not really comfortable. Tell them about some problems they could face in this new environment. Warn them about like troublemakers on who could like just give them some problems in school, and just give them a quick rundown about the environment, as she said. Yeah, that's all.
Awesome. Thank you very much. So if a new student is coming, how would you provide that support, or what would you do to?
Well, during my first year, I was lucky enough to have the, actually it's still my, when I first got here, I was lucky enough to have someone help me look around the school, guide me where everything is. And we had this opening ceremony where we had a grandfather drum. It was pretty fun. So hoping we could do more of that to help the newer students coming in. Along with our, at DFC we have a lot of good teachers, people who will help new students like me.
Thank you for that. Thank you very much for that. That's awesome. Yeah.
Well, I'm going to champion you guys
guys is see if you can put the communities in your hallways. All your communities that you're from, put them up there. So when they walk through the door, you can say, "That's me. That's me." And to make them feel like they're home. There's a piece of them are there. Just for an example, Fort Francis High School, you walk into their foyer and they have the flags of their First Nations in the school. So that would be a dream to have something like that. Like, this is us, this is who we are, we're here. You're here, we're here to educate.
That's awesome. Yeah, that gives them more of like a sense of like a home kind of thing, that somebody from your community has walked the halls of your school. Ladies and gentlemen, let's scream nice and loud. Okay, I'm gonna name them individually, and then I just want you to go crazy. Okay, let's say thank you to Jasmine Winters, Alexa Sagatway, Julian Beardy, and Andre McKay. You know what? I just gotta say, you guys did amazing, and the information that you gave out and all that stuff I noticed that there's a lot of educators out there, and they were writing notes. So whatever you guys said really helped them out. So again, thank you very much for participating in the student panel here for this conference for the best practices. I mean, this is awesome. So again, thank you very much. Yes, I'm feeling good. I'm feeling happy. We still got a couple more minutes, so what we're going to do is I'm going to ask you guys, we are going to participate in a few things, okay? Oh, hold on, we have a... Okay, oh yeah, I totally forgot. We have something for them. So on behalf of the committee and the organizing committee of the Best Practices Forum, we'd like to present you with a gift. So Alexa, we'll pass that down there. Julian, there you go. Jasmine, all the way back over there. And Andre, there you go. So again, our students for the panel, let's give them a nice round of applause. Yay! Okay. So now everybody is still waiting here. So it's almost lunchtime. So what we're going to do is, we've been sitting a while. It's time. Oh no! I know the locomotion was a hit yesterday because I put it on TikTok and there was about a couple hundred views on my TikTok. So yeah. So what we're going to do is, we're going to do this, and I need you to fully participate, just like how the students did here. They fully participated. They gave you the answers and everything, all that. So what I would like you to do is I would like you to find a partner. Find a partner close to you. Now, everybody's going to do this, okay? Come on, that's a game. Let's go, quickly. Don't be shy. Come on. Let's go. Find a partner and stand beside them. Now, keep in mind, I don't have music because our thing is a little, well, technical difficulty, so no dancing. So don't worry about that, okay? Quickly, find a partner. Let's go. We're going to play a little game. And those of you that are shaking your head, the students are looking at you. That's what I'm saying. The students are looking at you. The four students right here, they're looking at you. Okay, we're going to play a little game. It's called Anatomy. Okay? Can you hear me? Is it better? Or is it this one? Better here? Or this one? Okay. So what I'm going to do, this is called Anatomy. All right? I'm going to yell out two body parts, and you're going to connect them. Okay? Two body parts, and they connect them. So, Julian, you want to stand up? I'm just going to we'll use us as an example. So, Julian, if you want to stand up here. Okay? All right? Yeah, just stand right there. Okay, I'm going to say shoulder to shoulder, and then you're going to connect two shoulders, just like that. Okay? If I say back to back, you're going to connect back to back, like that. Okay? Cool. Thank you, Julian. Okay? Oh, no elimination. Don't worry. If you're last, don't worry. Okay? It's just about participating, and we're going to get our blood flowing. Okay, let's start. Shoulder to shoulder. Yeah. Okay, back to back. Perfect. Hip and hip. Okay, perfect. It's almost like a dance, right? Hip and hip. Right? Okay, let's go toe and toe. Knee and knee. Okay, let's go Let's try this one. Back of the knee and back of the knee. Perfect. That's good. Okay, good. Now I'm going to mix up the body parts. Okay, I'm going to mix up the body parts now. Okay? Here we go. We're going to go forehead, shoulder. One forehead and one shoulder. There you go. Perfect. I'm glad nobody went like this. I've seen that once. Okay, here we go. Top of the head, back. Oh, somebody's clip went flying. Okay, here we go. Hip and knee. Okay, all right. Toe and elbow. Toe and elbow. Okay, here we go. This is now the lightning round. You got to go really fast in this one, okay? It's almost like dancing, okay? So we're going to go really fast. Okay, once I say the two body parts, just connect them really fast. Okay, here we go. Let's go forehead, forehead. Okay, chin and chin. All right, shoulder and shoulder. Back to back. Hip and hip. Knee and knee. Toe and toe. Cheek and cheek. Okay, all right, that's good. I swear to goodness, I seen this cheek and this cheek come together. And I was like, holy ever deadly, those guys. Okay, one last opportunity for, we're going to line up really fast, okay? We're going to do this. And if you're, I need you to move your chairs and kind of push them up in front like that, okay? Keep in mind, sorry. Keep in mind, I don't have music, so you're not going to be able to, you're not going to be dancing, okay? Or maybe I'll do my beatbox. Okay, so you'll notice there's a big space right here, right? From that wall all the way to the table here, where the lunch is being served, okay? When I say the word G-O, you're going to line up starting from the wall over there all the way this way. But you must line up in the month of your birth. Okay? So January will start over there. You work all the way back here to December. When I say the word G-O, yes, holy, wait. Holy. Okay, so you're going to have to communicate. You're going to have to say, hey, I'm. Then you're going to line up together. Okay? Ready? Go.
Open Gangnam Style. Gangnam Style.
Okay, are we good? Okay, starting over there, I'm gonna go like this. I'm gonna point my finger, and I'm gonna go like this, and then you're gonna yell out the months. Now, this is what's gonna happen. If there is, say for instance, somebody says May, and then all of a sudden somebody says March down the line, or something that's off, then we have to start all over with a different thing though, okay? All right, so here we go. Yell it out nice and loud. Okay? Ready? We'll start over there. Go. No, just yell out your month. That's all. Okay, go. Oh, Awesome. Okay. Now, the students have challenged you for this next one. Okay? But I'm going to give you a time limit this time. All right? I'm going to get my clock ready here. This is a timer. I'm going to give you exactly 3 minutes. All right? This time you must line up, okay, alphabetically by your last name. Hold on, wait, don't start. 3 minutes. Now, if you guys don't get in within 3 minutes, the students get to line up first for lunch. And then you guys have to wait an extra 20 minutes before you eat. No, I'm kidding, okay? You're ready. On your mark, get set. Go! 3 minutes, go! Wow, okay. I seen there was a lot of pointing. Get over there! No, you're over there! Okay, you guys did it within 2 minutes, or within a minute. Where was it? You have 2 minutes and... Okay. We're going to start over there. They're going to keep pointing this way. All you got to do is just... You can yell out your last name if you want to, or you can yell out the first letter of your last name. Okay? So we're going to start that way, and we're going to work our way this way. Okay? Let's go. Hey, all right. All right, students, I guess you're not eating until another half an hour, thanks to all the adults. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, it's 12:55. Again, one more time for our students. And where I come from Fort Albany First Nation, we always let our elders eat first. So elders, by all means, you can line up, and then everybody else will follow them, okay? And students, actually go line up behind the elders, okay? Come on up, go to the elders, or go line up with the elders there, okay? And if anybody needs help with a plate or two, by all means, just let us know and we can come and help you with that. It's been a perfect morning. It's been an awesome morning. I'm loving the fact that everybody's participating and moving around. And it's good that stretching their legs and stuff like that. So it is now, let's see here. It's now 12:55. We will see you here after lunch. We'll get started about 12:50 for the teacher panel. And that's at 1 o'clock this afternoon, okay? After that, we'll have a break. Then we'll head into our trade show. And then we have a presentation, Decolonizing Classroom Management and Instruction with Candace Linklater at 3:45, which will end us off for the day for closing day two. With that, enjoy your lunch, and we'll see you at 1 o'clock.